Right, so everybody's emailed me, only there would be a late is now turned into our assignment. So, all right, the project was, as I'm sure you all know and are happy about, the project has been extended until next Sunday. The exam is on Thursday. I have the data path, and you probably recognize this is the answer from the quiz question as well as the homework assignment. What I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be going over this data path, and I'm going to be telling you what's physically going on as we go through each step. Right? So we're going to, as we compare and contrast this, you're going to see, you should have an understanding. As I kind of went, I went over with a student during office hours comparing this, and they were getting a much better understanding of why this is working the way it does. And specifically, see this, where is it, branch equivalent 6, and then later on, branch not equal 1. This is where this is going to make a lot of sense. But first, before I do that, the trade-off for getting an extension is you have to hear me rant like a grumpy Gus for a couple of minutes about coding and ultimately your career. I want to show you guys something. So if you recall, I showed you this earlier in the semester, this hardware engineer. This is a job solicitation, and it was for, you can have a BS in electrical engineering, presuming that's all of you, right? It's greater than 3.2. And I showed you all these qualifications and, you know, proficiency in synchronous design elements, including flip-flops, timing diagrams, and state machines. You all know that now, right? So programmable logic design, including VHDL, Verilog, synthesis, which you learned in 386. Computer architectures and interfaces. That would be that. So basic memory techniques and processor interfaces, also coding up your data memory, instruction memory, and registers. You can do that. You've demonstrated this. Understanding of computers and programming language, for example, C, and assembly language. So we go back to that. Being able to convert C to assembly language. Interested in learning about and working with digital technologies. And then scrolling down here. Now, this is what I want to talk to you guys about. So the reason why there are group projects, everybody has had some sort of nightmare group project in somewhere in their life, including myself, about dealing with somebody who's hard to work with, or if life happens, you know, things like that. You know, the reality is that's the way, you know, the real world works. So for those of you who are in the real world, I'm sure there's a couple of you nodding your head right now. Yep, it's not just school. You're going to deal with some of these bozos at work too. And so you got to learn how to kind of get over certain things. Specifically, here they're talking about take initiative, be a self-starter, and work independently. Like, you know, I know a lot of you are busy, but I know a lot of you also put the project off to the last minute, right? I've taught courses before, I know. I wasn't born yesterday. So if you put a project off, and put a project off, and you put a project off, and then you come around and you start asking me questions that make it very clear that you put the project off, you know, that's all well and good. I'm going to go, okay, well, I'm less remiss to help you with your grade. You do that when you're hired, guess what? Get out of here. I can hire somebody who will actually do it. So, there's another thing on this. This is why I'm showing this to you. The common complaint about young people, and I made the same complaint when I was young, was they asked for 5 years of experience for somebody right out of college. How am I going to get that experience? Or 3 years, or whatever it is. The way you make up for it in engineering is by group projects, by demonstrating you have code samples, by effective delineation on your resume. How many of you actually looked at that sample resume I posted on Blackboard? And you saw all the projects I listed, right? That makes up for it. If you spend a semester working on experience, industries count that towards your experience, right? So if you're putting things off to the last minute, all you're doing is demonstrating to a potential employer that you can't do the job. So there's some groups that are doing a very good job of kind of taking a half hour here, taking an hour here, splitting up their work, and then they come in and ask me questions during the course of the 3 weeks that the assignment was done. And the group that there's a group that submitted and submitted perfectly, and they're sure they understand that they're getting their 120%, right? as I emailed out. Other groups coming in at the last minute haven't dealt with their issues. We're falling behind. Taking ownership of goals, schedules, manages time as well. So if you're having an issue in your group, you know, everybody, one of the common things that people say is, I have this issue with one of my group mates. I didn't want to come to you because I didn't want to come off like a snitch or whatever you terms that be. So that's one that comes off. But you have to make that when you're doing a group project and, you know, you make a commitment saying, I'm going to do this. You know, I just fired a PhD student because he told me he was going to do certain things and then stopped going to class, stopped doing research. And that was a prolonged amount of time. And then I have to do the work, which makes me tired, which makes it, you know, I'm here till 1 a.m. on Sunday doing what he was supposed to have been doing, right? You don't want to be that kind of person. You don't want to be the person somebody looks back in life and goes, oh, that was a mistake. Nobody, and I know you all don't want to be that because y'all chose to be engineers. You know, you could have chosen, you know, an easier, quote, easier major, right? And been mediocre or done whatever. There's other shortcuts. But as engineers, you looked like, oh, this is going to be a hard major, and you said, I'm going to do that anyway. So I know none of you want to be basic and mediocre, right? I can tell you, if you're the type of person that comes in, I want to do the bare minimum, you're not going to survive much longer in the program. That's just life. So you have to realize that I've taught you all of this stuff, but in order to be successful, you got to learn how to do this stuff. And I can ramp up here until you come to class and do all this stuff and show you TGOs. But at some point, you know, it ultimately comes down to you, right? Like, you got to figure out a way to say, I'm going to be a better engineer today than I was yesterday, every day. That's what I do. How do I become a better professor than I was yesterday? How do I become a better mentor to my advisees than I was yesterday? You got to figure that out. And that's where coding projects come into play, challenging you to make yourselves better. And I know you all have the potential. So the homework, the median course average is a 95%, which is normal, and that's good. And I think all but 8 of you have some sort of A in the class. So, but there's an unusually high percentage of you that have below 70%. I think I've taught courses with 80 where I haven't had more than 2. You know, you have to make a commitment to showing up to class on time and, you know, submitting your homework assignment. And what's my course policy if you have below a 70% on your TGO homeworks? Get a D, and I'm serious about it. So those of you, look at your Blackboard, look at your homework average, and if you see that's below or close to a 70, figure out your ways to get to class on time, pay attention, do the work. Like, I had a conversation with one student, I won't say his or her name, but you know who you are, who really struggled on the first exam, but is doing incredibly well on the homework. I will help that student. Like, okay, that student's busting their butt. I will do everything in my power to help them get their grade because they're putting in the effort. If you have a 65 on your homework and you're failing your exams, if you were in my spot, what would you do? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, what do you do? You know, so most of you, for the overwhelming majority of you, that ranch is going, yeah, that's exactly what I'm doing. But for the 6 or 7 of you who are struggling on the homework, find a way to be the better engineer today than you were yesterday. I know students who halfway through the exam, through the course, and this will be the last thing I say before we get back to lecture, but who were struggling, and then it finally clicked. Oh, that's what Dr. Morrison is telling me. And then their grades shot up. And even though it might have gotten to an A in my class, it got them A's the rest of their way. Like, I was talking to a student last semester, like, oh, now I'm so glad you kind of kicked my butt because I brought my mom around the Grove and one of my students from last year tracked me down. Like, oh, he's my favorite professor because he kicked my butt and made me work hard. Like, I promise, I'm doing this because I care. So I want you guys to be successful. So do this, and I want to point out this last thing. I actually contacted National Instruments to find out what they pay this job that you're qualified for now. $71,655 plus a 401k plan where they match 3% per year. That's your value as sophomores. Now, If you get PhD, you get more, right? So I'm telling you, I'm doing this because I want you to be valuable. I want you to be good people, and I want you guys to. I mean, you're probably good people. I don't think any of you are criminals or anything like that. But I want you guys to be successful. Like, that's my goal. So,
backslash rant. Let's talk about this, because I think this will be a good way of helping you understand what's going on in here. So if we remember our code, the first line, we have, we are passing, one more time, if it just doesn't work, then I'm just going to give up and just stick here. So if you recall from this assignment, the first thing we have to do is worry about passing elements to an array. We have a pointer to an array, we have a pointer to an integer that we are passing by reference, and then we have an integer that we are passing by value. Now I'm going to have a copy of the MIPS green sheet on the exam. I've crossed out the one part that has the answer to the question that I'm asking you about, right? But understanding these instructions is going to be important. So first thing is we're passing an array. We have an integer array, and we're passing a pointer. So what's happening? First, we do an add I. So what's physically going on here is the program counter is pointing to 1. So this is a 32-bit value that points to the number 4. Now, why is it 4? Granted, you're in my office hours. We were going over this. Why is it pointing to 4 instead of 1? Don't overthink it.
Byte addressing.
Bingo. Exactly right. Byte addressing.
So here it's 4, and that's why it's also that value of 4 goes up here, and we add it to 4, right? So now we have PC plus 4. So now this is the value of the next instruction.
And then the value that,
so this comes to the read address, and the output of the instruction goes here. So we have a control 31 to 26 that goes to the control, right? And the control signal then sends everything out. Read reg 1 comes here. Read reg 2 comes here. We have this value here. Now, this is our first decision.
What type of instruction is add I? Yes. What does I stand for? So if it's an add immediate, what type of instruction is it?
R-type.
Who said R-type? It's morning. It happens. All right, so we have this decision here. We have to make it this multiplexer, right?
So this MUX, we have to choose our destination register.
Well, let's look at this type of instruction. We have add A0, S0, and 0. So here's the way this instruction works. We take the value of S0, we add the immediate value of 0, and we store it in A0. So that means A0 is our destination register. In an I-type instruction, which one is that?
RT.
Very good. Very good, Brian. RT, and which, and so 20 to 16 is which one, and 15 to 11 is which one? Yeah, 2016 is RT, 15 to 11 is RD. So if I have this multiplexer here where 0 selects RT and 1 selects RD, what's my value of register destination going to be?
0.
Very good. So now
we ascend 20 to 16 here to our write register. So now we pass this value here. This is 15 to 0. Now 5 to 0 gets passed to the ALU control, but
Since I-type instructions do not contain the shift amount.
Remember I told you at I-type instructions, the ALU op is 0, 0. Remember that truth table?
So what happens is, it's going to set this as 0, 0. So no matter what value comes from 5 to 0, it's just going to automatically send add to ALU.
So it's going to say, I have all these bits. Well, I don't care what they are. I'm adding.
So that sends that 4-bit value to your ALU. Now, here,
what's going to happen is we have a 15-bit value,
But as you guys know from having coded an arithmetic logic unit, you need 32-bit inputs, right? So somehow we need to change this to a 32-bit value. So we're doing a sign extension here. So
if it's, how do we know which 32,
what should be the, in this case, what should the most significant bits that we're adding on here, what should the value of those be?
Zeros.
What if it was negative one? Well, ones. Very good. Why is that? Because when you sign extend a negative number, you just keep adding ones. So now we have our value here
that comes up. So we have our this, and I'll come up to there. So we put this value that's from 25 to 21, our S of 0. Here, that comes out of RD1, right? RD2, which was also sent here and here, right? That comes out and comes to this mux. So we had our sine extended value of 0 come out here. And so our values are 0, we want RD2, which would have been A0, and 1, we want the value of 0. So what's the value we're going to choose for this multiplexer?
1, very good, right? Because we want the sine extended.
So that becomes this one. Sorry. That becomes this one. And it goes here. So now we have the value that came from our truth table.
To add, so in the arithmetic logic unit, we add the value here.
So it goes here and it goes around here. So I'm going to change this to green for a second. So this value of RD2 also comes around here and goes to write data. But our memread and memwrite are both 0
because we're not doing a load word or store word instruction. So this value of data memory is ignored. And then
you're going to just get a bunch of zeros on the output. And this actually technically don't cares because we use this multiplexer here. So it's mem to reg. So which value do I want? 0. Very good. So it comes back around. Comes back to write data. And reg write is going to be a 1. And it updates this register with this value.
So that's how an add immediate works.
So let me ask you this question. Coming back all the way to section 1, compiler-driven encoding of the microengine. Good design requires good compromise.
In an I-type instruction, ALUOP is always 0, 0. And that means what's the value going to be coming out here? It's going to tell the ALU to do what? Add. Let's say I wanted to do a subtract immediate instruction. So do any of you have your MIP screen sheet out? Okay, so
I can...
What's the opcode for subtract immediate? I'll give you a hint. It's a trick question. There's no subtract immediate in the instruction set. But let's say I want to do A equals B minus 5. How would I do that? Add negative. I've heard various places. So all I do is I do add I, and the compiler-driven encoding of the microengine, will automatically do the 2's complement and put that into the data path. So that allows you to not have to do another instruction, which makes your ALU control smaller. Remember I showed you the control design, and then I showed you the ALU control design. You have to code up that truth table. When you reduce that, that actually reduces the physical size of your data path, without any effect in performance. Because once the instructions are in instruction memory, they just go. So, same thing. So we've just put the value S0 into A0. So S0 contains the value, the base pointer of our array, right? So let's go back to this next instruction.
Here, let me... Now, why did I choose 32? So let's go back here. in my problem description, I talked about how you can point to, you may load to any pointer to an integer in the locations beyond the array. So, recall my array here, I said it has 7, right? So, 0 points to data element 0, 7 points to data element 28. So, those are reserved by the machine in data memory. So, we go here, bytes 0 through 28 are contain array, which means you can store the pointer anywhere you like. Now, what I said is I'm going to try to keep everything together. So what I just chose was the next one, which was 8, which 8 times 4 is 32. So let's say on an exam, I gave you an array list of 5. Where would you, you could store it in 24. You can store it in 28. It's not most operating systems optimal, but you could do that. Just as long as you don't store it in one of these. And it has to be a multiple of 4. And then it has to match what you do later. Okay? As long as you do that, it's an acceptable answer. Does that make sense now? So I did 32 because that just means it's in the data memory. I tried to use the what's the term I use? Locality, specifically which locality?
Spatial
locality. Very good. By putting 32, you're taking advantage of spatial locality. So you guys are going to get that National Instruments job. All right, so Brian, what's up?
Which pointer are you, the second line of the assembly?
Okay, right now we are writing this pointer. I'm sorry, we're writing first here. So you can do it in multiple ways. So I initialized store S1 into memory. That's first. So in your code, when you're passing a function to, now you have ampersand, right? That ampersand says pass it by reference. So what we're doing is we're actually coding up by reference here. So the first line of code, what we've done is S0 in the problem contains the base element of the array of we call it array here. So what I've done, we have 3 valid inputs, right? So I have done A0, I've put in S0 there, meaning I've put the base pointer of the array, S0, in main into A0 in the function. In the second line, now we're dealing with the passing by reference. So what we've done here, you remember when you're writing in C and you pass an array and it to a function and it changes the value in the function, right? This is why, because you're taking advantage of these assembler registers that pass the base pointer up to the array. Instead of having to pass the entire array to a function and then doubling your data memory, it's passing the pointer. So instead of having to go back here and going to 0 to 28 and then calling it A0 and then doing like 32 through 64, right? The reason you're doing that is because now you're not using double the data memory. You're just passing the same base pointer. So the trade-off is it's going to change when you get to the function. So that is why we've done this code this way. So, first line of code, we've taken the base pointer and put it into A0. So that means when we do everything later, A0 is going to be, well, how we change the function in, I'm sorry, how we change the array in the function. So next thing, we want to allocate into memory. I'm sorry, clear all, go away. Go away. Yeah, this has been. Right, so that's line 2. We are passing the value. We called it first by reference. Line 2 is how we do ampersand. Does that make sense? I know a lot of you struggle with pointers. Okay, good. Line 3. Now, I actually have to store the physical value
in the data memory. So I've said I have A1. A1 is 32, so this is my pointer, right? So now in order to finish putting first in, I have to store the value of first, which is an S1, into my base pointer, which is A1, and my offset, which is 0, because I'm pointing right at it. So we've set 32 to be the value of 32 here in data memory. So that means
32 is coming out of our arithmetic logic unit, and that is our address. So we have A1 coming from register 1 is coming here. 0 is coming, sign extended to 0. And now we have our pointer. So in order to get the value of first, in order to finish the ampersand first that we're passing to a function, we have to get the physical value of first out. That comes from RD2. So there is no destination register and store word. It comes out here. We get the physical value, and it circumvents this and goes here. So we have memWrite is 1. We have our address and then the data that we're writing to it, hence write data. So what we've done, let me go through this really quick. So first thing we do is we get A1, which is where we're going to store it. A1 is assumed to be 0, so we get 32, which is part of the function. We add it. So now we get the value of 32. It circumvents. There we go. It's more like it. Circumvents here, goes in here, and then we store 32 into the registers. Next instruction. Now, 32 is stored in A1. It comes out here. We have 0, which is added, and that becomes the point. So we're pointing in data memory. And now, my value of S1 comes here. We get it from read reg 2, comes out of read data 2, goes around the ALU entirely, and comes in there. So those two instructions are how ampersand that first physically works. Does that make sense? All right, third instruction. We're doing another add I, but here's how we pass by value. Second is just passed to the function as second. There's no ampersand, no stars, nothing. It's passed. Any change that happens in that function, we do not care about. It will not affect the value in main. And here is why. The value of S2 is stored. I'm sorry. The value of second is stored in S2. We're going to add that in 0 and store it in the third argument. That means any value that changes in A2 doesn't affect S2. The reason why we can pass by value is this instruction down here. After we jump to 12, and then it's going to jump back, right, to return address, which is 13. And you see we do add I, we do this load word instruction, because we're going to update the value in data memory of the passed by reference value, and then we're going to store it back in the local register when we get back to main. So we've done the third instruction. And now we have return address, RA 0 and 6. So basically what we're doing is we want this instruction to come back to, that should be 8, by the way. We want it to come back here. So once we're done, we want to continue in main and go back here. So here's how we do that. It's just another RA, but the return RA is register 31. We have reserved register 0. So I've done this. You can do another thing. You can do add return address 08. Or you could do add RA. Okay, so that's RA 0 RA. So this allows us to go to instruction 8, which means that when we get down here to JR, this will jump up to instruction 8, and we'll discuss that later. So next, we're going to jump to instruction 12, because the rest of this, as we recall here, We're calling our function, and then we have a few more instructions left before we turn to zero, right? In main. So what we're doing is we're jumping to this first line here. So here's how that physically works. We're going to jump to 12. So we have PC, program counter comes out here. We have PC plus 4, right? And then we come here. So the value of 12 is in instruction memory, and that is contained in 25 to 0.
Remember pseudo direct addressing? Here's how this physically works. We have a 26-bit value. Now the first thing we do is that value, now this is why it's 12 and not 48. Remember, byte addressing is multiplied by 48? Because it's physically hard-coded into the data path. So you have 26 bits. We want to be able to have the full range of 26 values if our instruction memory were that big. So by doing that, we maximize it by having a shift left by 2. Because if we automatically accounted for that, you lose 2 bits of being able to have a value of ability to jump. So that would mean that we have 4 times fewer instructions possible. So we've increased our number of instructions that we can have by 4, by a factor of 4, by hard coding SL2 into the data path.
So that becomes 28 bits. And then, Joseph, I'm picking on you. What's the word we're doing here?
Concatenate.
So 3128 means it's the 4 most significant bits
are then concatenated here
onto the jump instruction. Comes over here. Jump is going to be 1. Branch will be 0. And that updates our program counter to the next instruction. So no matter what happens here, we don't care because reg-write's going to be 0, mem-read and mem-write are going to be 0, branch is going to be 0. So I can do all this stuff in the ALU that I want, but as long as I have my proper control signals, it does not matter. So that allows us to jump to instruction 12. So now we have jumped to the first instruction of our
function. So the first thing we do is we get an array. Now, what I want to do is, if I were doing the exam, what I did is I would say jump, and I would leave this blank.
So the first thing we're going to do, before you do anything else, is figure out the rest of this, right? So we've called our function, and then we have to do this last instruction. We have sum equal second equals sum plus first plus second, right? So we pass the value of first by, I'm sorry, we pass first by reference, right? And we have a bunch of changes, and those changes are stored in data memory, right? So that's where they are. And if we want to do it faster, we got to load it into the registers. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to load word sum of where sum is and put that back into this location. So that's what we're doing here. We have selected VO.
If you look at your MIPS data sheet, VO is the result. I'm going to make that this real quick. So you have down here, you have register names of 32. So VO and V1 are values for function results and expression evaluation. So VO is where you're going to have your results. So that's the value that's being returned. And then you have A0 through A3. So you have up to 4 values that you can pass to a function.
So here, what the function is actually doing is it's storing sum as the value of the test function. So we have a register that we have specifically stored for sum. We go up here first, and sum is S3. So we need to get the value from V0, which is our result, and then get it to S3. So there's multiple ways of doing that. The simplest is just to do an add immediate here. So we're doing an add immediate. We're getting the value of V0. Everything that's been done in the function has been stored in this result. V0 is going to be read reg run. You have an immediate value here. You get the result, circumvents data memory, comes back and stored here. 20 to 16 is going to be our value of S3. So when you look at that problem, you say that's where I need to put the result. That's where we're putting it. So now that we have it in the local register, VO is gone, right? So now you can use it for whatever you want. So next thing we need to do is we need to get our value by reference of first. So now we have A1, right? We've been updating, down here we've been updating all of our copies of first. So we know that our value of A1 with a base pointer of 0 is going to contain our updated copy of first from the function, right? And then I need to store it back in S1 because in S1 in the problem states that's where first was in our local main copy. So what's happening? I have A1, it's been updated in data memory, so I need to go get it. So A1 is the base pointer. I know that it's 0. And A1, what's the number that A1 is? 32. Very good, right? Because it's pointing to the 32nd byte, 32nd, and we get 32, 33, 34, and 35, right? Because of byte addressing. We put those all together. We get them to data memory. Mem to reg is going to be 1. So it comes back around, comes here to write data, and then our write register happens to be, where are you? Here, S1. So that's how that's done. So that's what a point, that's passed by that, I'm sorry, that's passed by reference, that's how it's physically done. So the next thing is we have to actually add them, because we have our value from second pass, from our function, and we have the value of first that was changed by reference in the function now. So now we can do this last instruction. So we go here, this last instruction is second equals sum plus first plus second. So in our data path, we can only add 2 at a time, right? Because we only have 2 inputs to our ALU. That's why we're doing this the way we're going to do it. We're going to add, then we're going to store in a temporary register. Now, this is a really good example of why we don't want to store in temporary register. I mean, why we do want to store in temporary register instead of overwriting. Common mistake is students will add this and put it in second. So why is this, in this particular instruction, why would this be really bad?
Because
you're eventually going to add second, right? So when you have that stored somewhere,
it's going to
overwrite this value that you just wrote this function for. So what we're going to do instead is we're going to do a temporary register. And you can see here in the instruction, I have a temporary register. I have S3 and S1, which I see I have those updated. Sum and first are stored in temporary register. And then the second part, I have the temporary register plus second, the old copy. And then it goes here. So we have this old copy. So T0, we have an old copy of second. They get added, they circumvent data memory, they come back, and that's right there. So now we have the new copy of second. And so now that we're done, we see how this last instruction here is J of 0. That's return 0 in main. See how it starts at 1? Return 0 goes up to an instruction here, which we'll learn about in the next section. But basically, if you look at, I'm going to see where my screen is. So you see how here you have these, you can't see, but if you look at that TGO, registers 26 and 27 are reserved for the OS kernel. So what's going to happen is you're going to have some sort of offset, which we'll learn about. That instruction is actually, 0 is probably going to be a load word. What was it? How's it go again? It's 0, register 27, right? K0, right? And then it's K1 is the other one. So that means that's going to tell the operating system, I'm done with this program. Give me a new set of instructions. So what's physically happening here is once you get there, it does the same thing. We're going to jump, shift left by 2, concatenate. We jump to 0, jump, jump, jump. Everything's done. Goes to the program counter. Goes to that instruction memory. And it says, I'm done. Don't do anything more of this program. So that's what return 0 physically does. All right, so we had this value here, jump 12, right? So that means that we've done 11. We've done 11 here of our instructions. So we've done main. And now I know that the value I need to jump to is here, this next instruction. So I say 12, well, that's instruction 12. So I put 12 in there.
So instruction 13, the first thing I need to do is I'm passing a pointer to the base element of the array. So if we go back to our function here, test function, we have an array that we're passing. We have it passed by, we have a value that we've passed by. So here's what we're going to do to make this possible. First thing, I'm going to take A1, which is where I have the base pointer to the array. And the reason I did that is because you see, so we take A1 here, and with T0, because that's the value of first. So I put the value of first into data memory. So here's what I'm doing now.
I'm going into here, doing my offset A1. I am getting the value from data memory, right? I'm getting this value, it comes back around, and I need it somewhere to go, and I'm told a temporary register, store it here. So now I have that physical value here, and I've stored it in a local copy.
So every time we update T0, as you see, every time here, see, on instruction 20, we add I T0, the next thing that's going to happen is we're going to do a store word, where we're going to take the value of T0 and store it back in A1. And by doing that, we've actually updated the copy in the data memory so that way when we get back up here to this load word 8, instruction 8, where we load it, that guarantees that this copy that we're loading back when passed by ref, in the passed by reference value, will be able to update the copy. So that's what happens. Ampersand, doing all the stars down here, it allows you to update the local copy of the register. And then once you change it, you're going to change it in data memory, which allows you to get that value again. So that is how a pointer physically works.
So, okay, so we're at 12. Now, I want to get the value. I want to get a value here. So while array of first, so I have a temporary register, T0 containing the value of first, right?
So what I need to do is now we need to test our knowledge of how we get an element out of array when it's a variable. So what do I need to do here? If I have a value in a variable, and I need to get an element out of array, what's the first thing? What do I need to do to that value in the MIPS data path?
Oh, you know, you're already pointing to it. So if this is an array of 6, right, what would I need to do?
Change your offset.
To what? 24. Very good, right? So now, but I can't guarantee what this value is, right? It's going to be some sort of value. But as you guys have all pointed out, you have to multiply by 4, right?
So what could I do? What type of instruction could I do that would multiply something by 4?
Shift left logical, right? Very good. So here we are. So we're in instruction 13. I'm going to shift left by 2. So now I'm using I have a temporary register. I'm shifting left by 2, and I'm putting it in a different temporary register.
Why am I not putting it in T0?
You need the T0 later on.
Bingo, right? Because if you do it in T0, you're just basically taking the value and multiplying it by 4. So then we're in a loop now. So then you'd multiply it by 4 every time. And then if you were going into data memory, eventually
you'd exceed that 35, and then you're like, I want to go into some number down here, which
contains garbage. Now, when you do things like that in code, in Eclipse, that's when your program cycles. Because here's what happens. There's something known as a stack smashing attack. And what it does is it tries to update your data memory elements and just overwrite them all. So it goes and say, I'm gonna somehow manipulate your code into going outside of the memory elements allocated by the program. So here we have 0 to 35 to 34, right? 36, right? So that's what our program has for data memory. So the stack smashing attack would say, start at 0 and write over everything to 50. Or I could start at 50 and decrement and overwrite everything. So what happens is your program, I wish we had a better program. I'm working on getting funding for a better program for next semester that will actually give you, that'll tell you that you've done something called a segmentation fault. Are you familiar with segmentation faults? For those of you who've taken C++? So this is a segmentation fault. You have a certain amount of data stored in data memory for the program, and your segmentation fault says you have asked, you're getting load word or store word request outside of that range because you've done something where you've screwed up pointers. Like, remember that problem we did earlier in the semester where I had, I did it on exam one where you said, all right, I'm changing the pointer, now tell me what the physical value is. Here's the reason why you need to be cognizant of how that works. And if you want to do that review, I'm not going to ask on this exam, but you should do that to be more familiar. It will help you with your coding project. Is because if you don't do that, you go there, you're asking outside the range, and your program will freeze. And you go, segmentation fault, nope, bad. Nothing can go well when you go outside this range. In this case, our program from 0 to 35. So you've got 32, 33, 34, and 35. So if you had 36, your computer's going, no. So that's why. That is physically what a segmentation fault is.
All right. So we were at shift left logical, and now we're going to add here. We're going to take this multiplied value. We have T1 of.
So that's first times 4, and we have a base pointer to array, which we have stored in A of 0, right? And now that becomes our new pointer to the actual element in data memory that we need.
So we have this base pointer that points to this location. So if this is our data memory, in this case it's going to point to 0. And so whatever the value of first is, we've multiplied it by 4 by doing a shift left logical, then it's going to come out here, and then we're going to add them together. And so in this case, it's now going to go down to here, right? I skip it. So now it's going to add, and this is say now I have, and now I know the value is going to be here and here. So it's going to go here and store it in a temporary register. So then the next instruction is it gets that value out of the temporary register, that is this value, goes here. We have 0 is going to be our offset, goes here, gets that value, comes around, writes it here, and then it's going to write it to this particular register, which in this case is T3.
So now we've gotten
the copy from the array of this instruction. So now we have this value. So now we need to do some sort of branch instruction.
So if it says branch not equal, what type of branch do I want to put in there? Say it louder. Equal. Why? Because I want to branch if it doesn't meet the condition, right? So it's going to be the opposite. So on your exam, you actually array first equals 0. What type of branch should you do? Branch not equal. Very good. And then
you're going to come up with some sort of value here. So here, as you've correctly said, branch equal is T3, right? We have to compare that to 0 because in the code, sorry, I should have said one more thing. In the code, we're actually going here does not equal 0, right? So now we're going to go branch equals. Now remember in the MIPS data path, I'm sorry, we have a reserved register for 0, which will always have the value of 0, right? So here's what's actually happening. And now this is where we find out, this is another thing, you want to leave it blank for the time being until you figure out if you jump to 12, this is where the loop starts. In this case, in this instruction, we want to go to while, branch past here, and we're going to go all the way to this jump value. But we don't know what that value is yet because we need to figure this out. So you leave them blank, right? And so I want to get to 23. Here's the question. I've told you about this. You add one to the instruction, and then you figure out where you need to go. We need to get to 23. 6 plus 16 is 22. Why is it not 7? Here is why. In the branch instruction, I send 15 to 0 here. It is sign extended and goes past here to the shift left 2. This value that comes out of read reg 1 happens to be T3. The value that comes here goes here. ALU source is going to be 0 because it's a branch instruction. And then we have a comparison done in the ALU. If they're equal, it'll tell you this 0 bit and go here. Branch will be 1 and it'll indicate that I want 1 through there. Now here is what's physically happening. This value is coming here. We have shift left 2 and it's going into an adder to be added with PC plus 4. What does PC plus 4 represent? The next instruction, right? So the reason why it's 6 and not 7 is because the physical data path has already accounted for the next instruction. So you go 16, well, I want the next instruction automatically, so it's 17. I want to get to 23, so it's 17 plus 6. That's why in my, if you remember from when I gave the assignment and I had this comment here, it said branch 16 plus 1 plus 6 is 23. And I said, I believe button will get there. That's why, because it's already accounted for in the data path. Hey, does that make the branch instruction make more sense? All right, good. So now we get to this if first greater than or equal to second. So I already have T0 here. I got to compare it to second, which is an A2, I believe. Yeah, it's A2. So I know I eventually got to get to this last one, so we calculate JR here. So next thing, we have branch of equal. Now, if you recall from that topical guide objective where I gave the four possible scenarios, we don't have branch greater than or equal. We don't have branch less than or equal. So we're going to account for this by doing a set less than. So we have T0, which is first, and A2, which is second. And if T0 is less than A2, we're going to store it in T4. So if you recall from, you guys coded this up, right? So if T0 is less than A2, what's the result of T4 going to be? 1, right? Very good. Now here's why we want to have this instruction. Since we only have branch not equal, if it's 1, that means we've met this condition. So it's going to be 1. So T1 is not going to be equal to 0, and therefore we branch. And in that particular instruction, we only have sum equals array of first, which you already have gotten out of the value without changing, right? So we're only doing one instruction in there. So we want to get to 20, right? So
the value is 1. Why is this 1 and not 2? Automatically accounts for in the data map of the PC plus 4. So it goes to 19 automatically, and then add 1 to get to 20.
So in this case, if, when I was doing this type of problem, this would be blank, and this would be blank. And then I would do this. Remember, T3 is the value that we have for first, I mean, for array of first, right? So we did all of these. This is why commenting is very useful. So that's why I say array of first is equal to T3 over here. Right here. Because then I can say sum equals, so we've dedicated VO to be sum, right? If you recall all the way back, we had VO is equal to load word that. So we are now updating sum plus that value that we've done.
And so we're going to want to jump back to the top of the loop in order to have ensure that we've updated array of first every time.
So we do that by indicating it's just going to be V0 equals V0 plus T of 3. And so RS, RT, and RD. So we're going to get V0, this V0, going to go here. T3 is going to come through here. It's added. ALU source is 0. It's added. Goes around, comes back, past mem to reg, and then 15 to 11 is this V0, and updates. So then, I know I want to get past this instruction if we branch here, right? So now I go to this next instruction. So I know I want to get past 2.
I take the current instruction, which was 18. I add 1 automatically, which gives me 19. I want to get to 20, so I add 1 more. Therefore, I go back to,
this instruction here where I have it blank and I just write 1. And so this next instruction, we're just incrementing the value of T0 by 1, which if we look at our commenting, first equals first, we're incrementing first equals first plus 1 here, right? So we're doing that. So we've changed the value of T0. Now, before we can jump, there's one last thing we need to do. If I'm changing star first in the function, and I'm changing that temporary register, what do I need to do? What else do I need to do? Since it's passed by reference. If I'm changing the copy in the register in the function, and I pass by reference, what links the value, the register that we're using in main and the register we're using in the function? What links those together? Yes, very good. Store word, right? I want to store it here because remember this here, we do this load word of A1. So I need to change this 0 of A1, which A1 contains, what's the value that's contained in A1?
A1
is 32. 32, right? So 32, we update that copy in data memory because it's passed by reference.
So we do this store word here, 0, T0. We're going to take this value. We have A1 here, pass through there. 0 is going to come along here. They're added together, and they become an address. T0, which is the value we just updated, is going to be read data to. It's going to circumvent the ALU. And it's going to write that data to data memory. So now we have now updated the copy that we've passed by reference. So when we do this load word instruction up here, after we jump back, that's going to allow us to do this.
So we have, so now we have this jump instruction here. And the reason we have that jump instruction, if we go back to C, is
I want to go back to while loop. So if we go here, that means I find where my while loop started. In that case, it starts at instruction 12. So I simply jump to 12. So again, we come through here. 12 is multiplied by 4. We now have 48. PC plus 4, the four most significant bits are concatenated. Comes here. Jump is going to be 1. Branch is going to be 0, and then we tell it to go back to 12. So that's how the while loop works.
We're now back at 12. So then the only way to do that is if we break the condition, meaning that we branch with branch equivalent, you know, 1, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then we go to jump register.
Now, jump register is a slightly modified version of an R-type instruction, where it's going to give me RT. It's going to come out here, and then you could you'll actually for your final project design it, but you have a jump register control signal, and then that just comes here and updates your program counter. And RA is the value that we set here earlier, which I should have set as 8, but wrote 6. I'm sorry, 7, because we want to jump register. When we get there, we wanted to change it to this instruction here. So that's how you end from a function back to main. So to get rid of all of this, and let's go to Word, create a Word doc. Close. Let's get rid of this solution and let's look at the problem, right? How do I approach this problem? Here's how I would do this step by step, because I've kind of been alluded to it. First thing I would do is I look at the stated problem, translate the following code into C, into MIPS assembly language. Array is an array of words allocated in main where the base pointer to the array is in S0. So the first thing I'm going to do if I'm doing this is I circle that. First is an S1, second is an S2, and sum is an S3, right? So those are the values I need to refer to. The initial instruction is at 0. You may load any pointer into an integer to locations. Assume all register values are initialized to 0. So the first thing I do is data memory is going to be initialized here by the compiler. First is going to be 0, second is going to be 3. So those are all the register values. So the first thing I need to do is I need to do this. So I'm going to say, all right, here's my first instruction. I have the registers available to me, A0 through A3. So I'm going to say that the value of A0 should now contain the value of S0, because that's the base pointer to my array, right? S0 there. So it simply just becomes A0, S0, and 0. Also an acceptable answer. Add A0, S0, and 0. Right?
So just to clarify, when you're doing add immediate and from the S0 and the 0, that last 0, that's referring to the location in the array.
No. Gross conceptual error. So 0, so I'm make this font a little bigger. I'm trying to get this through this fast so I can prove to you guys that this problem can be done quickly. Okay, so.
No, that's from the immediate value of the instruction, 16-bit immediate. Oh, okay, so.
A0, S0. So next thing I want to do is I want to get this value of first and store it into an element in data memory. So, one last thing, paragraph. So I want to get that element, it's stored in S1. I want to pick a value in data memory. So I'm going to add I. So I'm going to pick A1. So I'm going to add, you could say A1 here. That's acceptable because we assume they're all initialized to 0. And I'm going to say 32. And then next thing I want to do is I want to load word S1, 0, A1. So now I've passed first by reference, and then A2. We're gonna that's RS is gonna be S2 because this is second, and I can do or zero. I can do add I S2 and 0 is an acceptable answer as well. So I've now called function. So now I need to have So see, I've passed, done this. I've loaded this value here. I've added this value here in a second, right? So this is going to be, and you want to keep track of these. You're going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. I want to have some sort of add, and we're going to say RA. RA is going to be initialized to 0, and I want to go back to the next instruction, right? So I would figure that out. I want to 6. I want to jump to a certain instruction. I leave that blank. 7 is going to be, I'm going to have the result of second in V0. So I want to do this next addition. So I'm going to do add temporary register T0. Sum is going to be V0. First is going to be S. Oh, I'm sorry, I screwed up. So I want to do load word S1, 0, A of 1, right? That gives me my value back. And then 8 becomes add T0, V0, S1. And then 9 becomes add sum was S2, right? The sum's S3. So S3, T0, and S3. So now we have second with second. And so 10 becomes jump 0, right? Because that allows us to go here, goes up to 0, which then tells our operating system to go away, right?
Second is S2. Shouldn't mine be S2?
Yes, it's S2. Yes, S2. All right. So now we've done all of that. And so instruction 11 in this case. We've got a little more sort of loaded everything. S1. Okay, so there's one other thing that I need to do. I need to indicate where we're going to jump back to, right? So I've done add RA, and so I want to jump back to this instruction, right? So that's going to be 7. That's why 7 shouldn't have been 6. Next, we get here. We have to deal with all these instructions, right? In array, I have that as the base element of the array. First, I need to deal with first now. So I need to load word from first. I have temporary register. I can say T0, and I can say 0 A of 1, right? Because now I'm getting that value. And second is already there, so sum is going to be 0. So I need to do this while array is first. So while array is first, so I need to shift left logical, T1, T0, and 2. So I've multiplied the value of first by 4. And then I'm going to do add immediate. I'm going to call this T2 because I want to do the array, right? I mean, I have a temporary register to the actual base pointer of the array. So this is going to be T1. I'm sorry, this is going to be A0 because that's where array is. And T1, right? Make sense? So now that's pointing to the exact element I want from data memory from the array to get first. And now I'm going to load word. I can actually do T2 again, 0 of T2. And that'll work fine. So now T2 contains the actual value of array of first. And then we're going to do 15, branch if equal, because we want to do the opposite of T2, 0, and then some sort of blank number. And then the next thing we want to do is we want to see if first is less than or equal to 0. So I'm going to do set less than. First is going to be set less. So I can call this T3. And I want to compare first, which happens to be stored as T2, right? So T2 and second, which is A2. So that means T3 is going to contain 1 if the value, if they're the same. So I'm going to do branch not equal T3 pound 0, and then I leave this blank again, right? Because now I don't know what I want to do. So next I want to do sum plus equals array. So then 18 is going to be add V0, because that's our return value. And then array of first is stored in T2, right? So oh, somebody should have caught my mistake here. This should have been, sorry, not that one. This should have been T1 because it's first, not. So this should be 0. This is T2 and V0, right? So now 19 is where we want to branch to because we're past this. So now we go back here to this one and go, well, I've already accounted for 1 because of PC plus 4. And I want to get to 19, so it's 17 plus 1 plus 1. And then I do this last thing where I do add I. So first happens to be T of 1, right? T of 1, T of 1, and 1. And then the last I need to count for in 20, I have to do a store word. T of 1. This is why you comment should be, all these should be T of 0 because it's first here. T of 0. T of 0, T of 0, and then a store. And the way you'll know is that it will match the load word from here on out. This becomes A of 1. So I want to get to 21. That's 21, I want to jump back to my the initial instruction, which in this case it was 11.
Mark,
yeah.
And the set less than shouldn't be T0 as well? 16.
What?
Set less than.
So I want to set up, I want to set. No, set less than should be, no, that's branch not equal. Set less than should be comparing first and second.
Yeah, so that's T0 and A2, not T2. And
A2. Oh, yeah. That's what you're saying. Yep. This is why I comment. I'm going against my own advice here. So now I want to jump past, so I want to branch past this. So this becomes 22. That would be the last instruction. That'd be JRRA. And then I go back here. I go as 15. Plus 1 automatically, so I want to get to 16 to 22. That becomes 6. So I did that problem in 5 minutes. So probably I have accounted, if I can do it in 5, that means I account for about approximately 20 on your exam. That's my math problem. I usually do 3 or 4 times based on the difficulty of the problem. This is a difficult problem, so you get 4 times what I can do. All right, so there are no TGOs since we didn't cover any. There's your exam, a big exam review. Does anybody have any questions on this? I'm going to post this immediately so you can use this as a good way of a study guide. The previous lecture, it wasn't the previous lecture. It was the lecture before where I did the exam review and I actually had the exam out. So, all right, I'll post this immediately since you all have no questions. And